Jesus is underwater. Chest tight from holding his breath, body heavy in the hands of his mentor cousin comrade John, who lifts him up out of the Jordan into the open air where he exhales and takes in a deep gasping breath with shimmering droplets still clinging to his woolly hair, water beating luminescent on his dark skin, with the heaviness of his clothing floating around him in the river. The heavens break open. God's spirit swoops down with the grace and precision of a dove in flight and rests upon him. And a voice echoes in the skies with words, "This is my begotten one, my beloved." Words bigger than the cosmos, as intimate as a whisper, closer than a heartbeat. After the Spirit descends and perches on a still soaking Jesus, after this voice rings out as he's still sparkling with the bits of light being reflected in the drops of water in his beard, after this legendary moment, a still damp Jesus is led by this same Spirit who cascaded out of the clouds, away from the river, and out to the arid, dry desert where we find him today. The story of Jesus in the wilderness is found in all three synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. In Mark's version, we feel more of the urgency of the moment when Mark makes clear that immediately the Spirit drove Jesus out from the water of the Jordan and into the wasteland. The geography of the Judean wilderness is marked by mountains and ravines and terraces and cliffs and dry riverbeds called wadis that only fill during flash floods. Today, we call that same area the West Bank, a Palestinian territory under the occupation that frequently faces arbitrary water shutoffs at the hands of the state. Mm-hmm. If Jesus were to try to return to Galilee from that region in our own time, he would face a wall, have to go through major checkpoints with armed guards, and have all the right papers. The Spirit led Jesus from the water of the Jordan River into this wilderness, the Judean desert. And we know from our reading what awaits Jesus after 40 days out in the wilderness. Jesus will face down the devil. But it was the Spirit who sent him there. It was the Spirit who led him, who drove him into the wilderness, where the devil was waiting for him. Why would the Spirit do this? Why would God send Jesus, God's beloved, into this place? I'm personally kind of disturbed by the idea that God, like, tests us or leads us into temptation or somehow sets traps for us. And my time in community organizing has shown me that it is the times of tension and discomfort that bring me clarity by rooting me in my identity and purpose and driving me forward. We call this intentional raising of tension agitation. And agitation in this sense is not just like merely annoying someone. When it's done well, it's not about shaming people or bullying them. Agitation is supposed to be grounded in deep relationship, where the parties know each other and trust is established. Agitation in these cases is done out of love, wanting to help people overcome the things that are holding them back. So the Spirit sends Jesus out to the wilderness to be tempted and endure some hard questions, in part so that Jesus can get clear when starting his ministry. Our conditioning has taught us to recoil from discomfort, to think of it as an inherently bad thing, something to like sidestep or evade at all costs. Instead of leaning into tension to see what we can learn from it, we often avoid it. But when we do this, when we turn away from tension, we fail to see the gift that this tension can be. We miss out on the clarity it brings with it, the opportunity for us to move forward. And the first thing that Jesus has to get clear about is his own identity. The devil begins this confrontation with Jesus by questioning who he is. The devil snakes some slippery self-doubt into Jesus' mind, hissing, "If you are the begotten one, if you are God's son." Remember that just before this, Jesus had just been told in the river who he was. In Jesus' baptism, a voice from heaven claimed Jesus as God's beloved one, God's begotten. We receive this same promise in baptism. As baptized people, we also are given the identity of one of God's beloved children, a part of God's own family, an identity that supersedes all other identities. And yet, like Jesus, we are often tempted to deny who we are. When the devil says to Jesus, "If you are the begotten one, if you are God's child," the devil's mocking Jesus. "You, the son of a blue-collar worker, you, born of a questionable woman, you, a race crushed under the occupation of empire, you, denied citizenship, you, beloved by God, who do you think you are?" But Jesus remembers that moment. The heavy soaked robe, the glistening droplets, the spirit fluttering down, the announcement from heaven, "You are my begotten one, my child, my beloved." It is Jesus' security in this identity, this clarity about who he is, that empowers him to face down the devil and win. The devil goes on to tempt Jesus with the sorts of things many freedom fighters and leaders of liberation movements face. The devil starts by leveraging a fear of scarcity. "You're hungry? Worried about feeding yourself and your family? Worried about providing for your physical needs?" Many people never begin radical movement work because they let these very real fears keep them frozen. I know that a major barrier to my own movement building work is anxiety about mounting debt, about security for my children's future, about having a steady job with health insurance. Empires in Jesus's day and in our own keep the populace from rising up and fighting back by keeping us poor and hungry and desperate for bread. But Jesus rejects this fear and proclaims that humans need more than bread. We need the word of God. We need truth and freedom and joy and beauty and art. We need to be focused on that world and build it, not be intimidated into making our dreams smaller so that we can focus on meager survival, a survival that was never guaranteed to us anyway, as long as our oppressors are in charge. Next, the devil brought Jesus to the top of the temple and told him to throw himself down so that the angels would catch him. It would be a miraculous sign that would catch the eye of many. Jesus was tempted to use this cheap gimmick to gain the attention of the masses instead of putting his head down and doing the real, hard grassroots work of building relationships. But Jesus knew better than to test God. Jesus knew that real and long-lasting influences come only with established trust. Instead of using some contrived stunt or the force of his own charisma, Jesus chose to live among the people, to heal them and speak with them, and then to invite them into the movement. Finally, Jesus was tempted to believe that the devil had control of the nations of the world, that the devil could turn them all over to Jesus if just Jesus would sell out. We face these same temptations to bow down to the false gods of capitalism, white supremacy, patriarchy, and all of their empty promises. The devil was clever. He knew that Jesus was powerful, but Jesus had a choice. Would he build power for selfish reasons, for ego, for money, or for fame? Or would he build power out of his own sense of identity as a human being worthy of dignity, out of his devotion to the divine, and because of his great love for humanity? Ultimately, Jesus cast out the devil and sent him away. Jesus chose to make his mission about God and God's people and not about his own pride. Jesus gave up a glamorous pseudo-movement based on his own glory and instead got clear about building a gritty, grassroots movement centered in God's vision of love and liberation. It was these crucial turning points where things got real for Jesus. He faced tension about his identity, about his motives, about his purpose, and he made decisions in the desert, rooted in the truth proclaimed to him in baptism. The stakes for Jesus here, they're high. After Jesus returns from his trying time in the desert, he learns that his comrade, cousin, and mentor John, the one who baptized him into this movement, John has been profiled, targeted, hauled off, arrested. He's sitting in a prison cell. This arrest, coupled with Jesus' clarity from his time of tension in the desert, leads to Jesus' radicalization in the beginning of his ministry. Once Jesus is clear about who he is and what his purpose is, what his self-interest is all about, he is able to begin to build his base and gather disciples for his radical movement. We have been spending our own 40 days driven by the Spirit out into the wilderness. Lent is a season in our tradition where we disrupt our own comfort, our own routine, in order to gain clarity about what's holding us back from loving God, ourselves, and our neighbor. We opt in to a time of agitation in Lent, trusting that it will make us more sure and more grounded and more creative and more free. As we march closer and closer to Holy Week, the stakes of our discipleship become clearer and clearer. The truth of the cost of this work should make us feel tense. If it's not, we are not being honest about what lies before us as followers of a Christ headed towards a cross. Our challenge then, this Lent and beyond, is to strategically and faithfully live into the disciplines that give us clarity and to dwell in the discomfort inherent in the process, resisting the urge to turn away from it. Praise God that we do not do this hard work alone. We do it with Christ, our sibling, who journeys with us in the desert, who faces these same very trials in solidarity with us. We have the witnesses of the saints, our ancestors who came before us, who beat down this path to show us the way, and who let us know that we are not alone. We have the company of our community, our stories of liberation, our songs of freedom, marked here in this oasis, in the waters of baptism, and nourished by the meal of Christ's own body and blood. This is where we draw strength to endure the hard questions of this life and to get ready for the revolution.